What's up, potheads and political junkies? You're watching Cannabis Culture News Live. I'm Jeremiah, taking out a nice bud here. Kish. Marius was smoking this on his show earlier as well. Very nice stuff. Gonna grind some up right now. What's up, guys? Friday afternoon, there's like some sort of fire in the neighborhood, evidently. I'm here at 307 West Hastings Street, downtown Vancouver, Cannabis Culture Headquarters, the BC Marijuana Party Vapor Lounge on the second floor at our Pot TV studio. A lot of names for this place. What's up, chatters? Good to see y'all. My name is difficult to spell. Jeremiah. Yeah, I even have a problem with that, Dr. Clone. So good to see everybody out there. I'm going to put some of this in the bong right away and tell you about what's on the show today. Will Obama actually allow U.S. states to legalize? That's the question we're asking today in the show. And to help us get that question answered, or at least to maybe answer with more questions, is Alan St. Pierre, Executive Director of NORML, and also Steve Kubby from California, one of the activists responsible for legalizing medical marijuana there with 215. He's going to join the show to talk about his new Pot TV show, Kubby TV, and about Eric Holder and Obama and their new announcements that they're going to virtually leave recreational marijuana states, so Washington and Colorado, up to their own devices to legalize. We'll see how that really goes, but everything okay with the sound out there? Yeah, it looks and sounds okay. Nice. Hope so. You tell me, Marius.
All's well.
All's well with the cosmos.
Yeah.
I'm going to hit this bong with this giant lighter. See, this lighter actually almost like measures up to the size of the bong. It kind of makes the bong look smaller, though. But still. Yeah. Pretty nice lighter. Jumbo light. Little flame, though. I was expecting a giant flame. Good rip to start the show off. Not that I'm a show off, but to start the show off. So, gonna do some Obama stuff today. Yeah, I have my own questions about this. We know that Obama has now said that he's going to leave them alone, but he's said a lot of stuff in the past. Of course, he said he was gonna leave medical marijuana states alone as well, but look what happened there. They didn't. They've continued to go after those states, even though there's 20 of them. They keep cracking down on them, arresting more and more people. We're missing a light over here, by the way. Maybe somebody want to throw that light on for me. yes.
Now, on the cord?
Yeah, little switch. So, yeah, we'll talk to Alan St. Pierre, talk to Kubby. We're going to also play a lot of videos for you today. Now, I've sent the videos to Marius. Marius, did you have a chance to look at those?
Yeah,
I've got quite the list here.
I can set them up as you need them. So.
Okay, cool. I'm just going to get them in front of me so I know what order they all go in. But, yeah, I thought right off the top we'd just talk about a couple of the current news stories that are happening here. Where is it? Sent. Here's my vids. So I wanted to talk about Justin Trudeau right off the top, actually, because we've been following the story of Justin, the young liberal leader, son of Pierre Elliott Trudeau, the former Prime Minister of Canada, and who was also a charmer, and everybody seemed to love him. He was like Canada's Kennedy or something, the way everybody speaks about him so lovingly. He's now passed on, of course. But Justin, the dashing young liberal leader, is definitely making waves out there. When he came out and announced that he had smoked marijuana, his poll numbers shot through the roof, and he's now killing Harper. And the Liberals were just decimated in the last election, totally robbed of all the seats they had. They were, at one time, the leaders of this country. The Conservatives managed to decimate the party and also gain a majority over top of them. And then basically make them the third party, so the NDP is even stronger than them. And now the NDP, of course, has abandoned all their I wouldn't say they've abandoned all of their principles, but they definitely seem to be waning a little bit, and I don't really like Mulcair very much or any of the things that he says. In fact, they seem like they're getting poised to get harder on marijuana and be criticizing Justin for his marijuana stance rather than saying he's doing the right thing. They're using this as a political issue rather than doing what's right. I hope the NDP does what's right, and I hope the NDP supports what Justin is doing and does the same thing themselves. That would be really good to see. We need to legalize this stuff, and the NDP needs to get behind that. We had Jack Layton on Pot TV talking to Mark Emery, and he said he was behind the issue. So things have definitely changed, though, since Jack left the party, unfortunately passed on, and not the leader anymore. All right, so let's, Marius, do you have that Trudeau video? Can you get that up?
Certainly.
I sent you... Oh, you got the Sensible BC one?
Is it the first or the second email?
It's in the second email.
Okay, no problem.
Yeah, it's in the second email. We're also going to play some video on the show for you that I shot at the launch of the Sensible BC CannaBus down at the Vancouver Convention Center down here at the waterfront. That was pretty cool. Dana Larson has himself a bus, a Greyhound bus, and is going to be traveling across the province collecting signatures for the three-month signature gathering drive for Sensible BC. That's to decriminalize marijuana in the province. Now, we have only 3 months to collect 10% of the signatures in every single riding of all likely voters. That's a hell of a lot of signatures, especially in the major areas. So we need everybody out there's help to actually get these signatures collected by going, if you're in British Columbia, if you're from BC, go right now to sensiblebc.ca, if you can, and sign up as a canvasser, and sign up as many people as you can. And even if you're just signing up your family or your friends or whoever, you know, your neighbor, your dog and cat, whoever it is, just, well, probably, I don't think your dog and cat are legal, but if they're voters, they're legal. If your dog and cat can vote, then they can sign. But, yeah, Marius, you can't find it?
No, it's there, but the video doesn't seem to be
coming out. It's not popping up?
Yeah.
Oh.
Well,
that is a crying shame, because this is a good video.
This one doesn't work either, because it's a link to the same page, is why.
Which one doesn't work either?
This Liberal leader.
Oh, the Trudeau.
Yeah, I don't know.
Well, okay, well, let's play a different video then.
Sorry,
then we can figure out how to play that.
I'll try one more time.
But YouTube's working, it's just CTV that's not? See, I was going to play the video right from CTV's homepage. I can watch it on my screen here.
This is the CTV homepage.
But for some reason, Marius isn't... Maybe your driver or plugin isn't installed to the latest version, Marius.
Seems unlikely, but maybe.
Who knows? Well, unfortunately, we won't be able to watch the Trudeau video right now. The video I wanted to play was a clip of Justin on CTV talking about traveling over the border because there has just been some recent news about a young student. She is just, you know, in school and she's in university and wants to travel down to the United States, but she got denied at the border for smoking pot, which happens to a lot of people. They asked her if she'd ever smoked pot. She admitted to smoking it, which, you know, she was being honest, and then, you know, said everything she had done, and then they denied her access based on that. So
I noticed that often when they say, when they ask that question, they say, oh, yeah, we won't do anything, you know, we're just
right.
asking. And then as soon as you answer in the positive, that they'll reveal the fact that they totally lied to you and have entrapped you.
Well, and there's actually a few really great news clips about that story. I don't have any of them here now. I saw one of them when I was at the bank, actually. I was standing in line at the bank, and they had the 24-hour news network up on there, and they had a great clip that was a really good interview with this student, and they went into the question, you know, this isn't just happening to her, but who else is this happening to? And they had people that were saying, you know, this is happening all the time. They had lawyers presenting information that this is happening constantly. This is not a unique case. And they even brought up the fact that Justin Trudeau, now admitting to using marijuana, may be in danger of not being allowed down to the United States because of his admission. Now, that seems unlikely to me that they would, he has diplomatic immunity of some sort probably, but he does talk about this in the CTV clip. So maybe if we can't get it played for you today, I'll find the clips of the student as well, and we'll play you both of those clips together. But Marius, until that happens, why don't we play the Sensible BC CannaBus clip?
Okay.
Is that one working?
Yes, it is. It's just...
Okay.
Gmail is being stupid. It won't let me open a message in a new window.
Oh.
I don't understand why.
Right.
I think it's Windows 8.
What's up, man?
Okay, well, here, I'm going to play the video.
While you're doing that, I'm going to load another bong rip. So the Sensible BC campaign
I've already
kicked off.
Actually,
you already muted me?
I haven't muted you yet.
Okay.
So Okay, you're back on screen.
Well, I was just going to say, this, the campaign, you can go ahead and play the video. It's all good. I was just going to load this.
Okay.
Dana Larson, the man, okay, in this video.
I'm going to play it and mute you.
This is a beautiful bus. It's been donated to our campaign. We're going to use it for the next 3 months. It's the CannaBus, and it's really going to be a wonderful mobile sign-up station. It's a billboard for our campaign. People are going to get excited when they see this bus. They're going to come running over to sign up, and I think it's really going to make a huge difference for our campaign's visibility.
Well, this is an issue whose time has come. The vast majority of British Columbians want to see a change in the marijuana laws and don't want to see their taxpayer dollars towards arresting and convicting people for marijuana possession. But our politicians in BC aren't responding to the people on this issue, so we want to have a referendum and force this onto the ballot so that we can have our voice heard. It's a big effort involved, but you know, we're going to sign up a lot more volunteers over the coming weeks. But if just each of those 1,700 volunteers just gets 4 or 5 signatures a day, every day, we will more than meet our target. So it's certainly doable. I expect our canvasser numbers to grow quite a bit over the coming weeks as we get out there in the communities and start signing up signatures. We're going to be bringing in new canvassers as well, and that is really going to help to swell our ranks and ensure we can succeed in this campaign. No one's ever tried a referendum campaign like this before. You know, we've had a year in advance planning. We've got significant funding for our campaign, largely from Bob Erb, the marijuana millionaire up in Terrace who won the lottery. British Columbians really care about this issue. 7 out of 10 people in this province want the law to change. But I agree, it's a huge job we have to undertake. It's by no means guaranteed. But if we pull together and if people who care about this issue come out and get involved, we can definitely make this happen.
Let's go back to when you first said, look, I want to make marijuana legal. People kind of looked at you strangely and they can't believe it. Who's this crazy guy? But tell us the difference now between then and today. What's it like now?
Well, I've been working on this campaign for over 20 years, really, to change the marijuana laws. But certainly when we launched last September and got things going, I mean, it was a lonely road sometimes getting out there, but we've built it one community at a time, one stop at a time. I've done over 110 talks about the Sensible Policing Act over the last year. We've managed to build up our support all over the province, and now we're really at the point where it's mushrooming, where we're getting exponential growth, and we're in a solid position to make this campaign a success.
Are people taking this seriously?
Absolutely. You know, we've been endorsed by all the major print media in Vancouver. We've had really positive support from our communities. Local media is very supportive. And really, there's nobody who's against this in British Columbia. The only sort of negativity we get is from those who don't want to discuss the issue. But I haven't heard a single person say that this campaign is wrong for British Columbia and that we need to keep arresting more and more marijuana users every year in our province.
So you have to get 10% of the voters in every riding. What ridings are you concerned about?
Well, you know, people ask me sometimes about the rural ridings, but actually I've spent so much time traveling through those areas and finding local canvassers that we have a lot of support. I'm actually more worried about Vancouver and Surrey, for instance, not because there's a lack of support, but just because we need so many signatures in a relatively small area that we need a lot of canvassers to get in there and make it happen. But even in the most anti-marijuana parts of British Columbia, there is still a majority support for this legislation, and so it's just a matter of us finding our supporters, getting their names on a piece of paper, and this campaign will be a success.
When you're on the road in the bus, is there offices or places in Vancouver if somebody wanted to sign up, or is it strictly, or is it on, can you do it online? I don't think you can.
People can't sign online. They've got to sign a piece of paper that's witnessed by a registered canvasser. We're going to have sign-up stations all around the province. We're still getting those in place. We only got the petition forms from Elections BC about an hour ago, so they're at the printers, and we're going to start canvassing as soon as they're off the press. But within a week or so, you'll be able to check our website. We'll have an extensive list of sign-up stations around the province, but certainly folks can come by our office. Just keep an eye out in your community. You'll be sure to see some Sensible BC canvassers out there.
There we go.
Sensible BC. Oh, yeah. Oh, it's 420 right on the dot.
Too.
There you go. Got this bong loaded. And then, oh, Megan, you should come up and hit the bong, too.
Okay, I'm going to hit this one first.
420.
Happy 420, everybody.
Happy 420.
I'm surprised you're actually
meeting. Hi, Megan.
Hi.
What's going on?
Not too much. It's a really warm day out there today.
It is warm. I know we've been having this another like heat spell.
Yeah, it's a total heat. Like,
it's weird.
Heat streak.
Yeah. It was getting cool, and then now it's back
again.
We
had like two thunderstorms back to back. That was crazy.
Yeah. That was cool, actually.
That was awesome.
No, it was totally nuts. We had this lightning storm that I've never, ever seen in Vancouver. I don't ever know if there's been one like this. We were downtown. I was with Jody in her apartment downtown, which is right in the middle of downtown, right above Granville Station. If you know Vancouver, you know where that is. And she's up on the 31st floor.
Yeah.
So we were right in the center of this damn lightning storm, watching forked lightning shoot all the way around the building. It was remarkable. Jody actually, we put the iPad down and recorded a bunch of video.
Oh,
and we have
amazing.
A whole bunch of video of big, massive lightning bolts. So I don't know if Jody's going to publish that or not, but...
Oh, she totally should. Like, I was downtown at a club, actually, getting the torrential downpour of rain.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I've never seen it rain like that anywhere. And, no. Like, you know, I've been in...
It was like it was Toronto
rainstorm.
Or something.
Yeah,
yeah, we don't get shit like this here.
It was absolutely nuts. And then, like, exactly 1 week later, it happened again. Because I remember it was both on a Thursday, because I was both out that night.
Weird stuff.
And, yeah, like, now it's just this crazy hot streak.
Yeah.
Like, thunderstorms
the weather.
Hot streaks.
Hash Mob said it's Harp. Ooh, yeah, probably. Yeah, look into Harp, HAARP, and Tesla Technologies used by the U.S. government for you.
Thank you.
Yeah. So yeah, what is it today? It's Friday the 13th today. Friday the 13th.
Oh.
And that's weird. We just had September 11th a couple days ago. We've done shows about September 11th before. People know my personal opinion about that. I'm a 9/11 truther. I believe that 9/11 was an inside job, or it was they let it happen, which means they made it happen, or maybe they actually made it happen and planned the whole thing. Who knows? But one way or another, those buildings didn't come down by themselves. They didn't come down just by airplanes hitting them either. So
rethink 9/11.org.
Yeah, there
yes.
you go. Yeah. Yeah.
Rethink
9/11.org. Sorry, a little bit of fire doesn't bring down buildings like that. It doesn't bring down a third building that happens to be a little to the side.
WTC7, look that up and tell me if that wasn't a controlled demolition. There's no way in hell that giant, massive buildings, like 47 stories wasn't WTC7. They just don't collapse into their own footprint, into a perfect pile with small fires. Yeah, small fires. No, it doesn't happen. Doesn't happen. There's many architects and engineers who have spoke out against the lies. Yeah, ae911truth.org, I believe, is the website.
Yeah,
Richard Gage, Canadian architect Richard Gage. He's a great guy. And actually, if we're talking about 9/11 researchers, look up Dr. David Ray Griffin, who's been to Vancouver a few times. I've had the fortunate chance to go and see him speak here. Fabulous stuff. Empirical evidence. This is no fucking
There's
around.
There's so much evidence
you know,
out there.
There, it's yeah. It's like this is the name of the game is empirical evidence, and there's a whole hell of a lot of it.
11 books he's written.
Yeah. This, you know. So there you go.
Awesome. Good shout out.
Okay. All right. Yeah. There you go. So, on to other news here. What was I gonna do next, Marius? I don't have the list of stuff in front of me. I guess I can bring that up. The videos. We played the Sensible BC vid. Oh, I have another video here about who's benefiting from the war on drugs. Who are the companies or the industries or groups that are actually benefiting from this drug being illegal? And, you know, when they say that they spend billions and billions of dollars every year on the drug war, what does that mean? Where does that money go? What are they spending it on? Well, let's watch this video. This is from RT, great source of information these days, Russia television. I guess they've been allowed to tell us the truth about a lot of issues. Vladimir Putin, the president of Russia, he's kind of a rogue himself. He's doing all kinds of crazy stuff these days. The New York Times just announced that he is the most powerful man in the world now. He has surpassed Obama as the most powerful man in the world because of his reaction to the US imperialism about Syria. So he has put his foot down and managed to actually stop the US in their tracks with the help of some blunders, I think, by Kerry, for one thing. John Kerry, who is now the what is he?
Seen
he's
as
seven,
a oh, failure.
Sorry.
As
I'm sorry about that.
He's in the Munsters arena. That's mean. Yeah, he looks strange these days, too. He's definitely looking more like bizarre. I think they're Botoxing. You know, I think both him and George W. Bush, like, you know, Bush's upper lip is all flat and kind of like doesn't ever move or anything. Yeah, that's Botox. Same with Carrie. He's doing the whole Botox thing.
That's kind of weird.
Yeah.
Not gonna lie.
You know, John Kerry is Skull and Bones.
Yeah.
Skull and Bones. Yale University. So is George W. Yeah. So are many others. So are like 11 people have changed
Kerry
family,
too.
Supposedly. Yeah, that's what I just said. Kerry.
Oh, yeah. Sorry.
Yeah, yeah. Kerry's a goofball, and I don't believe a damn word the guy says ever. Anything that's come out of that guy's mouth, I wouldn't believe for a second. Yeah. He just looks like a damn snake, man, when he's up there lying through his fucking teeth about Syria. It's just so unbelievable.
You got the Lindsay Lohan plastic surgery kit.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. No, it's not good. And I'm not a huge fan of John Kerry. But anyways, we're getting off track here. Let's watch this video about who's benefiting from the drug war. Marius, throw it down.
All right.
Well, the war on drugs seen as a failure, as South American countries blame U.S. drug policies for fueling cartel violence. But for some industries, the war on drugs is a profitable business. As the battle to crack down on minor drug offenses rages on, some companies are cashing in and getting rich. And it's these companies that pump enormous amounts of money into lobbying Congress so that drug policies continue to work in their favor. So who's benefiting? Contractors. The government spent over $6 billion on private contractors between 2005 and 2009. But that's not all. The drug testing industry is another one that's cashing in. The alcohol industry, private prisons, and drug rehabs are all reeling in the dough over the war on drugs. So who is really benefiting from the war on drugs, and will the U.S. change its failed policies? To discuss this earlier, I was joined by Mike Riggs. He's an associate editor at Reason Magazine, and I asked him where the billions of dollars allocated to the war on drugs actually go. Take a listen.
So at the top, it's going to enforcement efforts. So, you know, police budgets, municipal, state police budgets, federal police budgets. The DEA, for instance, has 10,000 employees, offices in over 60 countries. And then as it sort of trickles down, as you see the web spread, I mean, it goes everywhere. It goes to rehabilitation facilities, which are increasingly becoming an alternative to incarceration. And that's not, they're not an alternative because by chance or by luck, they're an alternative to incarceration because addiction treatment facilities are saying, make us an alternative to incarceration. The drug testing industry, again, because you know you're not allowed to have marijuana in your system at all, and it can interfere with you know, like workers' compensation benefits if somebody's injured on the job and they've had marijuana in their system. So these companies spring up to develop technology to test for drugs. And then you can look at obviously the alcohol industry, the private prison industry. It goes out though. There's more. There, trial lawyers enjoy this sort of the benefits of this. Tobacco companies do, and then military and defense contractors. So it's really everybody's getting in on it. And I would go so far as to say that we spend, you know, tens of billions directly and maybe tens of billions more even indirectly on fighting the drug war.
And so we are spending billions, and all these industries are profiting from this.
Oh, definitely.
But is it money well spent? Are we seeing any of this drug use curb within the U.S.?
No, it's not. And I think what we're seeing, what the trend is going to be, is as we shift to a public health approach, you're going to see less incarceration in prisons, but you're not going to see less damage done to people's reputations, their work life, their families. I mean, being forced to go to a rehab facility, those are expensive. They can sometimes have a waiting line. They're not always the most effective thing. I'm not sure that that's going to be great for people's freedom. Having to get drug tested regularly as part of your probation or as part of your punishment, I'm not sure that that's great for America's freedom. I think what we're just going to see is a sort of softer form of paternalism in the war on drugs. Maybe less no-knock raids, but no less interference in people's lives and what they do in the privacy of their own homes.
Meanwhile, the war on drugs isn't stopping people from doing drugs.
Absolutely.
As you just said. Instead, what it seems to be doing is just packing our jails with more people on even minor drug violations. And of course, who is benefiting from this? As you mentioned, the private prison industry.
Definitely.
Can you talk a little bit about how they are benefiting from having people locked up?
Yeah, I mean, so what they're promising shareholders is what their offer is as states continue to pack their prisons, join the United States incarcerates more people than any other country in the world. prisons in the United States just aren't built to handle this capacity. Every state in the country has prisons that are way over capacity. So what groups like the GEO Group of Florida and Corrections Corps of America, what they're offered to do is they build these prisons really cheaply to house overflow inmates. And for the most part, they're low-level offenders. They're nonviolent offenders, which means that they're drug users. And CCA said in their annual report in 2010 to shareholders, they said there are some things that are beyond our control, such as what states, how states decide to handle the drug war. You know, if they were to decriminalize or legalize or decide that they want lighter punishments, that's going to hurt our bottom line. And so on the one hand, in that report, they say these things are sort of beyond our control. But on the other hand, they have spent a significant amount of money lobbying for harsh laws, for three strikes laws, for mandatory minimums. And, you know, they're doing it because there's an incentive to make to lobby for those kinds of laws.
Now, President Obama recently returned from the Summit of the Americas in Colombia, and the president of Colombia and other South American countries urged him to change drug policies. One thing that they even recommended was the legalization of certain drugs. Oh, President Obama wasn't exactly on board. Here's what he had to say on the subject.
I don't mind a debate around issues like decriminalization. I personally don't agree that that's a solution to the problem. But I think that given the pressures that a lot of governments are under here, mm-hmm. under-resourced, overwhelmed by violence, it's completely understandable that they would look for new approaches, and we want to cooperate with them. I don't think that legalization of drugs is going to be the answer.
So he is facing this pressure now from the presidents of these South American countries because they're saying it's fueling drug violence in their area. And they're pushing for reform because simply, I mean, as we've seen, the war on drugs isn't working. And President Obama, he's saying legalization isn't the solution. But you didn't hear him propose any other alternatives, any other possible solutions. So if not legalization, what are some of the possible alternatives?
Well, looking back at the 2012 drug policy control report that the White House released last week, their idea of solutions is basically drug courts and pushing people into rehab instead of incarcerating them. I don't think this changes. I mean, that is a strategy. The White House strategies, what they've decided to do that's they're calling innovative, it's not really innovative, is for users. The White House still does not have a solution to black market violence, which we're seeing in Central America and South America. You know, I mean, some countries are even refusing to participate in our drug war program because they're so terrified of this and the ramifications it's had. Colombia is very slow. I mean, Colombia is touted as a model because of the Colombia plan in the 1990s, the way the United States went after cartel leaders down there, is that this is, Colombia is the model going forward. Well, Colombia no longer wants to fight the drug war. They're not interested in this anymore. Felipe Calderon is slowly, Mexico's president has slowly been walking back his support. And the Obama administration might not want to talk about legalization, but they have literally nothing else to talk about. They have no other proposals. And this whole idea that that the drug war in Central and South America is underfunded is a complete myth. I mean, we allotted $1.4 billion to Mexico for the Merida Initiative to help them fight the drug war. And that money has led to increased violence, 50,000 deaths since 2006. And as well as human rights abuses by Mexico police.
And so, how difficult would it be, Mike, to make changes to these policies, policies that seem to be failing when there are so many businesses making so much money off of it?
Yeah, I mean, I think this is a big question. I'm not sure that drug policy reform advocates have moved this far in the debate yet, but what we're going to be looking at is how do we answer the question of what kind of jobs program is the drug war? And essentially, that's what it is now. It's not a public safety campaign. It doesn't, any public safety that taking a drug dealer off the street is completely eliminated by the fact that you're encouraging this competition to move in with violence. So it's what do you do with the 10,000 agents that work for the DEA? What do you do with over 1.2 million law enforcement officers in the United States who either are, you know, some of them are assigned to the drug war, but many, many more get their funding from asset forfeiture when they conduct a drug raid and they confiscate houses, cars, money. So the question becomes, like, if we decide to end the war on drugs, which I think it's inevitable, it's not working. And, you know, for the first time in America's history, we have a majority of people who want to legalize marijuana, for instance. So the question becomes, what do you do with all these people? And how do you reallocate those resources to where they're being, you know, productive and less harmful towards Americans? And I don't have an answer to that question, but I think that's where the debate is moving.
And we are seeing that he has more pressure on him to do something. And it's been a decade since this war on drugs has been dragging on. How long can it drag on before some real changes are made?
Yeah. That's a great question. We have 16 states with medical marijuana now, plus the District of Columbia. Colorado and Washington both have legalization efforts on their ballots in November. So I don't think this is going to come from the top down. I think what we're going to see more of is we're going to see more states legalize or decriminalize, and then we're not going to see any bad effects from that. You know, we're not going to see an increase in car accidents. We're not going to see an increase in violence. We're not going to see an increase in, youth truancy or bad grade, anything like that. And I think once those cases start to make themselves, and for instance, we already have Portugal as a great example of what decriminalization can do. I think once just that, as you know, the slow march of history will eventually change policy for us.
All right. Thank you very much, Mike, for coming on the show. That was Mike Riggs, associate editor of Reason magazine.
Okay. Looks like it.
You can tell me.
Hi, I'm David Melvin. You're back.
Okay. I just want to announce the Marijuana Movie House free popcorn from now on.
Sit down for a second, David.
I got to run.
Oh, you got to run?
I got to run. But anyway, free popcorn. First Thursday of every month.
David Melvin, curator of the Vancouver Herb Museum, announcing that on Thursdays, right here at movie night, at the second floor of the BCMP Vapor Lounge, free popcorn for all who come in. So if you're thirsting for popcorn, it's good stuff too. They have like the full real popcorn stand. Like the guy comes in with the, you know, heats up the whole thing, makes it, pours the butter over it with the crazy canisters. I've got some photos of it up on Facebook and on our Cannabis Culture Flickr page if you're so inclined to go check out the popcorn photos. I love popcorn. I love that popcorn too that Med Mark always brings me. That's good stuff. Yeah, Crazy Dave is giving away free popcorn down here at the BCMP Lounge, and because he wants you watching his movies. So we're going to get Alan St. Pierre from NORML. He's the executive director of NORML on the line. I thought we'd... Is there one more video, though, Marius? What was the other video we wanted to play real quick here? maybe not. Maybe we should just bring Alan on, and then we'll play the videos afterwards.
All right.
We could do that.
Yes, we could.
We could. It's up to us. It's our choice. We're in charge. It's our show. We can do whatever we want. Please stand by. So you have to tell me about sound, Marius. Tell me if that's good, if I need to do any audio adjustments over there.
Should be able to do the whole thing from the board.
Okay. We're jacked. I can bring this down a little bit too, actually.
Yeah, that'd be good. Whoa. Yeah, but that's okay, I got it.
Alan.
Hello.
How you doing? It's Jeremiah from Cannabis Culture.
I'm well, thank you.
Excellent, Alan. Good to hear from you. Awesome. Thanks. It's sounding good, Marius. We're just
good
making sure the sound's okay, Alan. So,
sure, no problem.
Alan, you're in Washington, D.C., aren't you?
One more time, please.
Are you in Washington right now, Alan?
I am looking at a beautiful sunset in Washington, D.C.
Ah, very nice. Of course, that means you're 3 hours ahead of us here on the West Coast in Vancouver. And so, Alan, it's great to talk to you. I haven't had you on the show in a while. Great to have you back.
Thanks. All kinds of great stuff going down.
Oh, man, there's a lot to talk about. Since we had you on last, just a ton of stuff has happened. We always seem to have you on to talk about stuff happening with your president, Mr. Barack Obama. Because of some of the pivotal things, of course, that he's been announcing these days. And so the question today, Alan, on that we're trying to find out on the whole show is Obama really going to allow the states to legalize recreational marijuana? And so that's why I wanted to have you here today, to see if we could resolve some of those things or if there's just more questions maybe. But there's a question. What do you think, Alan? Is he really going to let this happen?
Well, I think in a two-part answer, one, to a degree, in the 4.5 years he's been president, that has largely happened. Colorado and New Mexico, Vermont, Maine, and Rhode Island, in his presidency, Americans of those states who have the proper qualifications have been able to walk into retail establishments and buy cannabis products, and do so in a way that is even more lawful than you and I have experienced in places like the Netherlands. So Now, of course, that's only for those who qualify or claim qualification for a medical use in states that have that list the specific disease types that they would qualify for. So we've always sort of estimated that for about every 9 cannabis consumers, one is a legitimate, bona fide medical consumer, leaving the other 8 consumers as people who use it for recreation, religious, sacrament, creativity, etc.
Right.
So that has happened. That has happened. The second part of it is basically this DOJ memo that came out last week, which would be the third memo in his administration. This one waves the green flag the most profoundly because they sat for 296 days, if I'm not incorrect, from the time the citizens of Colorado and Washington voted to go over the Rubicon to legalization. It took 296 days for the administration to finally come up with a public statement. In reality, they didn't say anything officially, publicly, in all that period of time about what were these 2 states, let alone 9 states that have retail access to medical cannabis, let alone 20 states in total that have changed medical cannabis laws. So that memo and allowing these 2 states to become sort of this cliche term in the United States as laboratories of democracy, that's what they're allowing them to do. And the hearings were sort of odd in the sense of the Senate doesn't have any legislation pending in front of it having to do with these reforms. The House, the Congress, has 7 or 8 legislative reform bills ranging from legalization to decrim to medical to sentencing reform to banking to industrial hemp. And the Congress almost certainly is not going to even have a subcommittee hearing. So there's such a disconnect between the states that are moving in a direction of reform, and here in D.C., generally speaking, the Congress isn't going to do anything. And then the third branch of government, the courts, I don't think reformers at all rely at all on the federal courts, thinking of the Supreme Court most notably as vehicles of reform, most especially, good ones to employ. They're there, but they're tough rows to hoe. So that leaves the executive and the executive branch. And while we would have liked to see an executive order, for example, where the president actually breaks out the pen and creates a vehicle that really changes the way that the federal government perceives something or engages in a particular policy. But in this case here, having a memo that tells the federal prosecutors around the country, particularly in these states where this retail access is going to go on, taxation is going to go on, now we have to get behind the brass tacks behind the scenes regarding things like banking laws and regulations having to do with the federal workers and military personnel who are in those states. And for that matter, even universities, because universities are subsidized by the federal government. So there's all kinds of concerns. There's some crazy stuff also that gets negotiated behind the scenes with these states, like, can they come up with a way to determine that if you buy marijuana in Colorado and you drive to Kansas, for example, that somehow, you're going to set off some sort of like anti-marijuana detection device.
Yeah.
I mean, some of the stuff that they're talking about trying to do behind the scenes is kind of tomfoolery, but at a minimum, the federal government now has had to, at base, acknowledge if they don't do something and allow these states to develop policies that can regulate themselves, then the federal government can't make them enforce their laws. So it's sort of like they're sort of casting in the direction of political chaos. So you've got it's a tough choice, caught them short, political chaos or marijuana legalization. That's kind of where the federal government finds themselves today.
Right. Now, Alan, let's get into a little bit more detail about what the memo actually says. Can you go over what some of the key points of what the government was actually coming forward with?
Well, again, this is the third memo in 3.5 years. and this is, would be called the second Cole memo, because a gentleman named James Cole was the author of it. And it has one major thrust, and that is that there will be 8 points that the federal government says are their priorities regarding marijuana and how these states go about implementing their policies. And some of them are pretty sensible regarding driving impaired and children having access to it and control mechanisms. So they sort of lay out in this now well-publicized memo found readily on the internet. It's, you can read this, it's about 3.5 to 4 pages long, and it just basically lays out, it reiterates much of what the last two memos said, that states have this autonomy to some degree. The federal government retains its right to seek an injunction, but it also acknowledges that it doesn't know that it would prevail. Our Supreme Court currently is fairly conservative and claims to defer to states' rights, and right now there couldn't be any better example before them on states' rights than what these states are doing on marijuana.
Right. Now some of this, to me, Alan, this is the worry that I have, that a lot of the language used in the memo this time around is similar to some of the other memos about medical marijuana, and how Obama has, you know, issued memos saying that he was going to leave medical marijuana users and distributors and so on and so forth alone in those states where medical marijuana is legal. And of course, we've seen that Obama has cracked down harder than George Bush did, even on those states. And even, you know, people who are following those laws, or who we seem to be following those laws, are being targeted as well. So it's, they're not even sticking to their, what they're saying, they're not sticking to their own rules that they're loosely putting forward.
Well, yes and no. The vast majority of those arrests and busts have been in the state of California, and this is where this gets quirky, understanding the way that the states work. California, while the first state clearly to have medical marijuana laws in 1996, it hasn't actually passed any laws that allow its legal use in retail access. So that, for example, when you go into a retail store, there's a license that's above the cash register. They don't issue that. There's no taxation officially. So when the federal government says that we're going to go in and enforce federal law, in the absence of state control, really the pox is on the House of Sacramento in California, who over the last 10 years has allowed about 2,500 medical dispensaries to pop up in California, but to basically subject them to the whim of both counties, who 50% of the counties in California do not allow dispensaries, 50% do, and in those 50% that do allow it, they've become sort of easy fodder for the federal government, because, you know, obviously if people are lined up to walk in and buy cannabis, if you take away the guise of medical use, this is all just a massive conspiracy in the eyes of the federal government. There are easy cases to make. So most of this mishigash has happened in California, and that's why this week it was kind of notable that, you know, as soon as this memo came out, California legislators quickly redrafted a bill to try, and which is being debated right now, on whether or not to basically, like what Oregon did a week and a half to 2 weeks ago, and a number of other states, and that is to go from self-preservation laws that did open themselves up for federal intervention to now, once the state becomes a player and they issue licenses and they have quality control checks, and of course when they get the money from the taxes, in those particular states there hasn't been that much federal intervention.
That's right. Yeah, so the big stuff they're not really going after. It's just kind of, Well, that's very good to hear, obviously. So it's your feeling that this is just going to get better, Alan, or what do you think?
Oh, yeah. No, this is all going to get, increasingly better across the board. Yeah, in every way, shape, or form. Culturally speaking, the numbers still just keep going up. Public opinion. In fact, you know, I can break some news tonight here that we're just about to release polling from Oklahoma. Oklahoma, the reddest, most conservative state in the United States. Oklahoma NORML will release data that'll be in papers on Sunday, indicating a majority of Oklahomans support outright legalization.
Wow.
And women, most notably, even more than men. And so it's a change that seems to now be quite deeply rooted.
Yeah, it's true. It's happening everywhere. There seems to be no shortage of attitudes switching over to our side. It's really awesome to see. Now, about the latest stuff with Obama, I know that there was some testimony in Congress over the last few days about this issue. Alan, can you tell us what's been talked about in Congress? Isn't it, there's been some reaffirming of the government's position.
Yes, in terms of this hearing last week in the Senate, are you speaking of?
Yeah, that's the one. Yeah, in this, yes.
Yeah, so this past Tuesday, the Senate had a hearing basically calling the heads of the lawyers from the states of Washington and Colorado, along with the Attorney General, Assistant Attorney General of the United States, Mr. Cole, who wrote this memo, and to basically in a two-hour hearing that was broadcast widely, that the gentleman who called the hearing, Mr. Leahy, a Democrat from Vermont, and he and all the other senators who were on the dais, all former prosecutors, basically, except for Mr. Grassley, a Republican, they were all representing states that have medical marijuana laws. And they were talking in the first person about their constituents and harassment from the federal government. And so they sort of acknowledged that, you know, these times have changed, federal law should probably change. This memo seems to move them in that direction. Of course, the guy from the Justice Department court have swatted it back in their court, saying, well, you know, if you want banking regulations and you want to see these changes, you, the Congress, made these laws. You can change these laws anytime you want. And judges have told the Congress that and others. So I think we all know that the real onus is on the Congress, who created these crazy laws in 1937 and then reaffirmed them in 1970. And today find themselves caught between now 25 states that have changed their laws substantively, two to the point of legalization outright, and yet, again, we'll have not even subcommittee hearings, let alone committee hearings, let alone going to the floor to the vote. None of those things are going to happen under this Congress, particularly under the Republican-led Congress. So, you know, the states is where the action is going to be. In 2014, it looks like Oregon and Alaska will be up next for legalization initiatives. If they fail for whatever reason, I suspect in 2016, Oregon will join California, Maine, and Massachusetts with popularly supported initiatives where polling is already coming in at the 60 percentile or more. So these big reforms are going to be happening. We surely would just like to see them happen at the federal level, but the pressure is going to keep coming from the states, most likely.
Yeah, that's really great to hear. And so now in Washington, I've been hearing about what's happening there in Washington State as they get set up to actually start to have stores, government state-run stores that are selling marijuana to the public. And I've heard that there's some controversy over the taxing levels, though. I know that there's a lot of tax and the percentages are getting pretty high. I've heard conflicting reports on how high those taxes are actually going to be. But, Alan, have you heard about how that's progressing there in the state?
Oh, indeed. In fact, news this week out of Colorado, specifically Colorado NORML, came out to take basically a neutral position, originally sort of a opposite position, but now they've publicly taken a neutral position on a public vote that's to happen there to affirm taxes higher than what we had anticipated in the initiative process. The government, not surprisingly, hungry for more money, has tacked on higher taxes at the local and state level. So in Colorado, this is a controversial. You've got even Grover Norquist, a sort of notable conservative anti-tax advocate in the United States, has come out saying, you know, hey, if we're going to have marijuana legalization, fine, but should we overtax this product? No, that doesn't make sense. So That is definitely happening at a controversial level. But just a couple of quick, you know, notes here, at least in the United States, and I know it's very similar in Canada, you know, alcohol, distilled spirits, are taxed at pretty high levels, and not a lot of people necessarily complain that we pay, you know, $25 per gallon tax on a bottle of vodka or something like that. Or more understandable, if you buy a bottle of beer in the United States, you basically are about 45% of what you pay is going to taxes in one form or another. If you smoke a cigarette in, like, New York City, 90% of the cost of what you pay for that cigarette is going to taxes. And while nobody wants to pay high taxes or more taxes than you know, they want to, I don't think that when marijuana is legal, and it will be legal, that it's going to escape what we could all describe as vice-level taxes. And that certainly at the beginning of when it becomes legal, now that governments are sort of so starving for this money and using it as a justification to go from prohibition to legality, we'll be saddled with these probably at the beginning. But in time, I think what we should all be arguing for, because we have such a strong case to be made, is we should be using sort of a harm reduction model on taxation so that, you know, caffeine and marijuana get very, very, very low taxation. And things like beer and wine get moderate taxation.
Right.
Things like cigarettes and hard liquor, you know, get, you know, higher taxation just because they sort of logically have greater harm levels, greater intoxication levels, or greater addiction levels. And
right.
So
they
had, in
they
time,
take a cost of...
I think it's... What, go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say they take a larger toll on society, so I think there's some sort of a, more of a justification for the government to step
yeah.
in and take more cash for it, but... Still, yeah, if marijuana doesn't hurt anybody, there's really no reason to, you know, take a bunch of taxes for it besides just a money grab.
Yeah, and so the part of the balancing act that reformers and consumers are going to have is just that, the money grab between, you know, ultimately government that says, you know, hey, we want to get this money rather than you all these years giving it to the so-called black market. So for me, if marijuana is allowed to be grown outdoors, and it can be a pennies on the pound commodity crop, just like, say, for tobacco is, that it's really only us as a society and our collective wisdom and our ability to influence whether we tax these products super high or super low or whatever, that we can get the product down to such a low per unit cost point that, you know, there is no smuggling, there is no destabilization of our borders. You don't have people paying, I mean, $100, $200, $300 for dried vegetable matter,
yeah.
which we've all done almost all of our lives quite willingly, but absurdly, like tulips, 300 or 400 years ago. It's like our tulip nightmare. And so
yeah.
I think that's coming to a close sooner than later, but that can be screwed up. I mean, if government, for example, says you must only grow marijuana indoors, right off the bat, they're going to make it, by my calculations, based on these really large grow outfits we've looked at in England and the legal ones from like GW Pharmaceuticals or some of the illegal ones I've been privy to in my lifetime. But, you know, if you're going to grow it indoors, even at 50,000 square feet, it's still going to cost about $1 per gram for the farmer to produce. And by the time you sell that to a consumer, obviously it's going to be triple or quadruple. So you'd be paying $4 for a gram of vegetable matter. A gram of vegetable matter, when today barley, corn, sorghum, tobacco, whole leaf, these things sell for, like, you know, hundreds of dollars for the ton. A ton. So obviously we can produce massive tonnage of cannabis outdoors. And in doing so, we should be able to drive the cost down to incredibly low amounts for consumers and patients.
Yeah, absolutely. David Malmo Levine is sitting here with me, Alan. He has something to say. David, what's up?
Don't you think, Alan, it'd be a fairer comparison to kind of compare medicine crop to medicine crop? Like, right now, it's not cheap to get, say, the best Jamaican-grown Blue Mountain coffee. It's not cheap to get herbal medicine, even though it's legal. Other herbs, such as mullein and coltsfoot, that are smoked, they're cheaper than cannabis, but they're not as cheap as sorghum or some sort of food product.
How many people are growing them, though?
Yeah. Well, I'm just saying, like, I think that the price is going to go down post-legalization, but I think it's unrealistic to expect it's going to be a penny a gram.
Yeah. Well, we were just...
Well, I mean, I think it's certainly unrealistic considering that that's, government's going to, make sure that they're going to get a higher cost than that. But if you, predict, the fields, not just in a place like Canada's central region, but anybody who's driven across the United States and you're driving for days on end, thousands of miles of some of the best soil on earth, this grows remarkable row crop. And we can grow cannabis as one has... Those who have seen it in Morocco and Tunisia and Mexico and other places is pretty huge, multi-thousand hectare plantation. So even under prohibition, I've seen cannabis produced at incredibly low costs.
Right. Yeah, I think, David, you kind of came in a little late on the conversation as well, but I kind of agree with Alan on this one. If it was done right, the possibility is that it would be extremely cheap because it is extremely cheap to produce it. So it... If it isn't done right, and there's a bunch of, I think what your argument is that, I think your argument is valid, that there's problems with everything else in society as well, with all of these other industries. But somebody's putting a volume on the music or something. Thanks, Marius. But that's a problem with every industry. That's not just a problem with cannabis. There's over-regulation, exactly. And there's all kinds of things that happen with every single industry.
Right? I don't think our goal should be to grow cannabis as cheaply as possible, because then you're going to get chemical fertilizers, you're going to get chemical pesticides, and you're going to come up with swag. I think
you could still grow it properly and have it extremely cheap, even if you did it right.
Well, I think there should be organic standards. I don't think there should be a prohibition on any drug, but I do think we should make chemical fertilizers illegal, because they're killing the soil and killing the microbes and the earthworms and the farmers and the consumers, really.
For my own view, we could certainly right off the bat begin with a veganic standard. How's that for cannabis? But just right off the bat, we're going to begin with, as consumers, that we know that something like veganics begins with, if we're going to interface at the botanical level, then let's begin in veganics. And so certification, I would think, would be a given for sure.
Okay. And then people, if they're going to smoke post-legalization, they're either going to smoke the best buds around, or they're going to smoke hashish. There's no reason to smoke swag. So to grow really good buds, you want to grow it in a greenhouse. That's going to increase the cost. You're going to want to give more attention per plant and not treat it like wheat.
Well,
so it's not going to be pennies per dose. It's going to be a little bit more than, it might be less than a dollar a gram, but it's not going to be a penny a gram. The other thing is, you're probably going to want to remove the vegetable matter entirely and just smoke full melt, clear dome bubble hash. Because then it's heated plant matter per dose, especially chronics. People who are used to it. They want to catch a buzz. They don't want to be smoking rope for 1 or 2% THC. They want to be smoking the most potent product possible. So
some people,
For those people,
that you and I, all of us have grown up with, in 20 or 30 years, college students are not going to be rolling blunts. They'll not be hitting bongs. They will not be, drawing pot through a pipe, generally speaking. I have seen the future, and the future is definitely a concentrate form where the botanical has been largely removed, and you get down to the active ingredients as best as possible, and to superheat that product. Certainly vapor pens, I would suggest, particularly in a state like Washington or Colorado right now. As an adult, if you're on private property and somebody hands you a vapor pen, load it with a concentrate. The idea that you no longer have to look over a shoulder, you no longer have to have any fear whatsoever. You can take a long draw off of that vapor pen, and I would suggest, as you have indicated here, that is likely in the future of how cannabis will largely be consumed for those who want it in that form, even if there will always be some super cheap, you know, alternative in the botanical form that's out there.
You know, I know this is like we're getting off on a tangent by talking about this, but I wanted to hit you up a little bit on that particular issue about concentrates and vapor pens and that kind of thing. Because when I was at Seattle Hemp Fest this year, Alan, there was a doctor who was speaking on the panel in the Hemposium tent. And I got a little bit of the video. I haven't published it yet, but he was mentioning some interesting stuff about some of the research that they've been doing into dabbing and about the differences between the consumptions of these concentrates and marijuana itself in plant matter form. And he was saying that they're actually seeing, for the first time, an actual like withdrawal symptom and physical addiction symptoms from high levels of using those concentrates. When people are flooding their system with so much of them at once, they're actually seeing this type of behavior that they've never witnessed before. So he was suggesting that maybe cannabis actually might be physically addictive on some level once it's pushed past some, you know, reasonable limit. But he also said that maybe there's something to be said for some of the chemicals that are being used to extract the cannabis itself, and even some of the things that are used to smoke it, like the vapor pens. And you know, I'm not so sure that all those vapor pens are safe with the little metal springs and elements and the weird things they have inside.
Plasticky things, right?
Yeah.
We're going to see these white papers. In the next few months, because peer review often takes minimally months to do from the time you research, publish, do the peer review, publish it. We're going to start seeing those white papers come out here soon. I've seen some of them in the form of drafts that are being circulated amongst the authors and the researchers and the houses, the publishing houses that are looking for people to edit them. And so they're out there. They're going to be coming in the next 6 to 10 months. We'll have a better idea of what is happening. Same thing with, for that matter, spice and K2. These are all fairly new phenomena that humans haven't really interfaced that much with these products as much as we are right now. And so this is all incredibly contemporary science. And I think there's something to the discussion regarding the comparison to high potency products can cause potentially more harm and quicker addiction, the want for more, etc. I would certainly suggest that, in all the years that NORML has had conferences, which is about 40 years, some of the best marijuana and hashish products have been smoked by hundreds of people at every event. And no problems, no concerns. But over the last 2 or 3 years, as concentrates have come to the conference, people who have used marijuana thousands of times in their life, will find themselves trying a vapor product in a concentrate form, particularly under a bell, which I think in this situation they're simply taking in too much air at the same time. But some of these people just literally collapsed. And while no problem, I mean, just put them in the corner and they're fine. But wow, that's pretty stark.
Yeah, greenheads.
We certainly,
they're happening a lot more.
I think anybody who's been around serious cannabis culture has seen this in the last 2 or 3 years.
Yep.
Yeah.
Undoubted. In fact, we've even had some of our own experiences on the show with people actually literally passing out right on the show.
All right. I'd like to add a couple of things to the discussion. One is that I think for lightweights, for people who are novice users or beginners and people who don't like to smoke too much, I think the joint will always be the ideal mode of administration, simply because you can get a small dose and then put it out and control your dose more easily than you could concentrates. The other thing is, I do believe there were some studies done by NORML in the 90s that indicated that the heat was the most damaging element of smoked cannabis. And so there will always be a need for double filtration or triple filtration water pipes, like glass bongs, will always have a place as an ideal mode of administration for people who want to remove, I guess, the most dangerous element from organic cannabis, which is the heat.
Right.
Yep.
Well, there you go.
Anyway,
thanks,
I gotta
David.
Run, but thanks for letting me pop by
thanks,
and
David.
Say hi.
And Alan, I wanted to ask you about some more of NORML's work. Recently, there was this on the front page of NORML, you guys covered an issue about this judge who was a DEA judge. And now 25 years ago, he came out and actually said that cannabis should be reclassified. And now, now tell me how this relates to NORML. This is a judge who was actually working on an ongoing case that you guys had brought about, isn't it?
In many respects, this is probably the most important case intellectually. I would suggest this kind of lays the baseline for almost anybody to understand the dysfunctionality that the government had regarding its scheduling of marijuana and how it viewed it. So in 1972, NORML launched this lawsuit, NORML versus DEA, where we weren't seeking to legalize marijuana. We were already working on that on separate tracks. But under the Controlled Substances Act, Schedule 1 means it can't be used for any medical purposes. It can hardly be used at all for even research purposes.
Right.
So we thought that, you know, it doesn't make any sense, obviously, and how could we ever get to the point of legalization if we can't at least, it can't be acknowledged that if you're sick and dying, if a doctor can't prescribe it to you under guarded conditions, how is it ever going to be that we could use it in our houses privately without fear of the government? So that lawsuit started in 1972, and it's one of the longest lawsuits in U.S. history. It went ultimately till 1994. And what you're alluding to is this now 25th anniversary of the most important part of that case, where after 16 years, the DEA, in three different cities with hundreds of witnesses, heard all this different testimony arguing whether marijuana should or should not come down schedule. And so on September 9th, I believe, or 6th, the 1988, he came down with this ruling on a 68-page decision that was absolutely beautifully written. His name was Francis Young. He was the chief administrative law judge of the DEA. And he not only agreed with NORML, he just took it to a completely new level of saying things that many of us have quoted many times, like, marijuana is the safest active therapeutic substance known to man. Marijuana does not cause overdose. Marijuana is safer than most foods that we eat, et cetera, et cetera. He laid all this out in the argument, telling the DEA, you need to reschedule marijuana, and if you don't do it, then you're arbitrary and capricious. So sadly, I can report the government can sometimes be quite capricious and arbitrary, and so in 1988, rather than listen to their own chief administrative law judge, they appealed the decision out to the appellate court, and so from 1988 to 1994, we fought it and ultimately lost a 2-1 decision where we chose not to appeal it to the Supreme Court because we thought it was way too conservative and we'd make what lawyers call bad law. And if we probably had lost that case, then there would be no medical marijuana law that would have passed in California in 1996. So in many respects, it was a case where had we lost it, then ultimately lost it, meaning that the judge ruled against us and didn't find that we had merit in the case, then to this day, it's hard to imagine that there'd be any medical marijuana anywhere in the world such as we know it today. There'd be no medical cannabis in Canada, where the Health Canada, you know, very quickly said, all right, fine, we'll come up with a system, and flawed as it is, at least they have a system. And none of that would have happened had Judge Young's decision not come down acknowledging that the federal government had wrongly, incorrectly, bizarrely scheduled marijuana at schedule as high as that. And so we just, you know, with 25th anniversaries being what they are, it was hard not to recognize that in the history of marijuana law reform, that's probably a pretty significant day on the calendar.
Yeah, no kidding. Well, what a crazy story, too. And man, you guys have been doing a lot of hard work for a long time. And Alan, I wanted to ask you about the future now. So what is the next state to legalize? Who's going to be up next, do you think?
Oh, no doubt. Oregon and Alaska are the two states that in the off-year elections have the best chance to get on the ballot. Alaska, they don't have a choice. They have to do things in non-presidential election years, so they can't do it in 216, which a lot of us are gearing up for much bigger efforts in California, Massachusetts, and Maine. So those are the two states that look like if voters could go to the polls today, they would probably pass something that would look very similar to what happened in Washington and Colorado. I guess for a lot of us, the next real test is going to be, and the big tea leaf, is not so much a voter initiative. I mean, I think we all have a lot of faith that if you put the vote to the public will generally give us the wisdom that we should change these laws. But that's not how most laws are made. Most laws are done, of course, through representative democracy. So what would be really great, what would be incredible, is to see a state legislature and its governor sign a bill that would legalize marijuana. And in that respect, I think the states that are probably the closest to that are Maine, Oregon, and Rhode Island. All of those states have argued, debated these things. In Maine last year, Democratic Representative Diane Russell came within 3 votes within their lower house, if you will, of legalizing marijuana. And she's pretty sure now that that new memo came out that we were talking about earlier, when that memo came out, she now thinks that she can, you know, pick up those 3 votes. And so this fall, she wants to bring her bill back, and there's a good chance that thing could pass. Now, it doesn't mean that it would pass in its upper house, its Senate. It doesn't mean that its governor would sign it. But I would suggest that that's really where this is. When a state goes to that level, when it actually passes a law and the governor signs it, then we move to another level.
Right. Awesome, man. Well, Alan, thanks a lot for coming on today. Much appreciated. We always love having you on. Tons of great info. But now, Alan, one more question. So as we move forward, in the U.S., I guess there's still, I mean, it's not over yet. There's still a heck of a lot to be done. So what do you think is the, if people want to dedicate their time and effort to something in the marijuana movement, what's a really effective way for somebody, average Joe, just to do something to change things? Where's the best level to hit these things at? Is it still on the state level, I guess?
If they can take a two-tier approach, it would be great, and put most of their effort at the lower level. I mean, I often say if you have a dollar in your hand, spend 90 cents of it at the local level and spend maybe 10% of it at the federal level, because those, if the locals change, they put the logical pressure on the federal government. So same thing that happens in Canada as much as the United States. So that's, and in that respect, people have to get political. You know, it's boring, it can be mind-numbing, but they've got to get political. They've got to go to those meetings. They've got to put some skin in the game. You know, $5 and $10 donations, just that little amount to a candidate who's potentially in favor of reform, or at least to get their attention and then have a symposium with them to write, of course, to just simply lobby their legislators and say, I want you to do this. Because legislators are kind of, if done correctly, are puppets, that they turn around and see what the public opinion is, and if they see a sufficiently high enough change, then they generally move without opinion. And they definitely know that there's been a sea change of opinion regarding marijuana, whether they're conservative or liberal. I guess the other thing, too, is to be in touch with the media. I mean, write letters to the editor, to contact columnists, to call into radio shows, to ask the radio shows, for example, to have debates. What could be better, and it's really great radio, as you know, to have people debating. And so why not have debates? It'll light up the TV and light up the radio lines. And lastly is to, and this is the level that I think it's probably going to have to get to before we really see crazy amounts of change, and that is a degree of civil disobedience. Having just a couple of weeks ago participated in these 50th anniversary march celebrations here in D.C., it was really humbling reminder to see that when individuals really want to see change and they're willing to face, like, the gnashing teeth of dogs and water cannons and big men with clubs who will beat them to the edge of their life. We as cannabis consumers are pretty placid. We have not really stuck it to them in a Gandhi, Martin Luther King-like way. And so I think that we all have within us the want to do that sort of turn yourself in day. Go grab a big fatty and go to the local police station and fire up in there and say, go ahead, arrest me. Let's begin this process. And we all know that if that happens in any capacity, then the system can't handle it. And there has to be some acknowledgement that the system is completely hypocritical, where alcohol, tobacco, and pharmaceutical products and caffeine are all readily available, but cannabis is not. So you're right. You are so right. This is not a military mop-up job. The war is not over. We cannot whistle by the graveyard. But there's no doubt that things like that have been going on in Colorado and Washington, the Senate hearings, public attitudes, Uruguay, I think sooner than later Jamaica and a few other countries are going to move very quickly away from the single convention treaty. It is an incredible time to be a marijuana activist.
No kidding, man. Well said. And much agreed. Excellent to have you on, Alan. Thank you so much for coming on. Alan St. Pierre, Executive Director of NORML. You can find out about all their hard work at NORML.org. Amazing stuff every week from NORML.org. Go there now. Alan, thanks a lot, man. We'll talk soon.
All right, be well. Take care, Jeremiah.
Yeah, you too, Alan. Have a good night. Alan St. Pierre. Yeah, I love that guy. I love NORML. They do a lot of great stuff there. Paul Armentano there as well is a great guy. Also a former contributor to Cannabis Culture magazine. So, yeah, that was really great. I'm glad to hear such a positive sort of spin on things. Though Obama, they might be, like, you know, not doing everything they say about the medical marijuana stuff. Alan seems pretty positive about the whole thing for the most part, but we'll see what happens. We're going to have Steve Kubby on to talk about an article he has worked on for Cannabis Culture we're about to publish. He doesn't really take such a positive spin on the whole thing. He has a little bit more of a grim opinion of what's happening with Obama and some of the lies that he's been telling about the medical marijuana stuff, and how that relates to the recreational stuff we will talk to him about. And I want to also play some more videos for you before we do that, or at least one that I have lined up. Marius, we have a video from CNN. Now, this is about kids and marijuana use for medical purposes. This is about, I think she's a 9-year-old, or sorry, is she a 7-year-old, actually? Uses medical marijuana, and CNN's done a little clip about it. I thought it was a good clip, just wanted to play it. This is Sanjay Gupta on CNN, the recent convert to our side. Sanjay, who was against pot, who wrote a column for a mainstream... Yeah, you can take that away if you want. He wrote a column for a mainstream paper saying why he doesn't support the legalization of pot. He thinks it's a bad idea. He says no on pot. But now he's come out and said that he was wrong, that he apologized to Americans for misleading them about marijuana. He said that it's a medicine, that it's good. And he is CNN's main doctor correspondent. And actually, funny thing, Sanjay Gupta was asked by President Obama to be his Surgeon General. So Gupta would have been the Surgeon General of the United States. I guess maybe he's more free to talk about whatever he wants when he's not under that obligation. He probably wouldn't come out if he was the Surgeon General. But
definitely not.
No. So yeah, Marius, can we watch this one? This is kind of a positive little CNN piece.
I don't see why not.
Let's watch it then. Sanjay. Dr. Gupta.
Would you let a first or second grader or any child use medical marijuana? Some family members in Oregon say yes. 7-year-old Michaela Comstock has an aggressive form of leukemia. Michaela is a registered medical marijuana patient. Her mom gives her the drug every day. Not surprisingly, there are some, including her father, who have concerns about this. I mean, after all, she's 7 years old. Dr. Sanjay Gupta joins us now with more, and we wanted to get your opinion on this.
Well, I mean, you know, the first question a lot of people are going to ask is this even safe to do? And this ends up being the crux of a lot of questions surrounding marijuana. What is hard from a purely scientific standpoint is that it's an illegal drug in the United States, so it's hard to do studies on a drug that's illegal. So you often look to other countries to try and get data. And it's also, and here we're talking about a child, so it even makes it more difficult to do these studies in children. So we don't know a lot about the safety overall. We do know, in Michaela's case, there are 51 other children in Oregon who are also registered to be able to get medical marijuana. So she's not the only one. This is something that the doctors have obviously prescribed for not just her,
so,
but other
people. So tell us how marijuana is administered, because it's not like she's sitting down and smoking a joint, right?
Right. Well, there's all sorts of different ways as well. People are used to thinking of it that way, but it also can be in baked goods. It can be in a capsule form where you're actually taking some of the active ingredients. THC is the ingredient people talk about quite a bit. It can give you that feeling of being high, but it can also, it's a very good nausea medication, for example. And this is not anecdotal anymore. This has been proven in studies dating back to the 1970s. So people who are getting chemotherapy, for example, can take this to try and prevent the nausea associated with that.
So in Michaela's case, it did ease her pain. And some have even gone so far, I think she's in remission right now, right?
Right, right.
So some say that the marijuana helped kind of cure her leukemia. Is that possible?
Well, you know, if you're talking specifically about its effect on the cells, I think that's harder to say. But all the other stuff, I mean, chemo is a very toxic drug, probably a lot more toxic than cannabis is. But all the side effects that you get from that, the marijuana, the pain, as you mentioned, just from the cancer itself, a lot of those types of things can be treated to some extent with you know, the THC, the way that she was getting it. Now, doctors will say, are there other ways to do it that are less toxic, more have a higher impact? We don't know. In her case, it seems to work. And as I say, in a lot of other patients who are young, we do know in people who start before the age of 15 and keep doing it throughout their life, even sporadically, tend to have an impact later on in life. They lose about 8 IQ points on average. Again, these are hard studies to come by. That was a study out of the Netherlands. But for adults who do this, you know, at past age 15 or past adolescence, certainly, the long-term impact in terms of safety, you know, there's not a lot really written to say that it's necessarily a problem.
Well, it's easy to sit back and criticize the parents in this case, criticize the mom, but when you have a 7-year-old kid in terrible pain, you want to relieve their pain.
Yeah, you know, and I read the whole article and I've been following the story. I don't know what the relationship is between the parents and the doctors here. There are clearly doctors in Oregon who think that this is a viable form of treatment. I'm not sure where the communication breakdown here is. There is even FDA-approved versions of this that can be given in adults as well and children. So, you know, there are options for them. They're doing it a little differently. I'm not sure why that is. But as a treatment, though, in adults, I think we're beyond the anecdotal, beyond the sort of, you know, there's actual studies. In children, it's harder to come by. But again, you are getting more and more children part of these registries.
Yep.
He's
the one
that bought Princess
Alba. No way. Wow, that's crazy. Hey, Steve. How you doing, man? Oh, I'll call you on Skype. No, we don't have the whole Skype thing set up right now, Steve. So if we do you by phone, is that okay? We're actually live right now.
Okay, let me turn off the camera here. Do a couple of things. That's how we were going to be on Skype.
Oh, yeah. Sorry about that, Steve. Yeah, no, we don't have all our Skype equipment set up today. Just a little easier to do it by telephone. Should have gave you the heads up.
Yeah.
But so, yeah, we just talked to Alan St. Pierre, Steve, about his thoughts on the Holder Obama situation and what they're saying about pot. And he had a very positive sort of outtake of the whole thing. And he didn't think that... I asked him about the medical marijuana situation because my worry is that Obama says he's going to leave recreational marijuana alone, but he's also said he's going to leave medical marijuana alone. And he hasn't, at least according to what I've read, he hasn't left them alone. And that includes people who aren't doing things illegally. But when I asked Alan that, he didn't really necessarily agree. He thought maybe a lot of the stuff was that they were cherry-picking easy stuff and that it was people actually breaking laws or, you know, a lot of it was happening in California where things are hazy and so on and so forth. But it seems to me that there's a lot of Obama lying going on. And I don't know, what's your take? I know you're working on an article for Cannabis Culture, so I do know your take. But explain what you think to our guests, to our viewers.
Well, it's not a matter of what I think. It's a matter of the fact that stand before us And the fact is that Eric Holder and his deputy, Cole, have issued the memos. The memos have no legal standing. The memos themselves say that they can decide that it's not worth it to go back raiding, arrest, prosecuting everyone. So I don't know, I wish I had the same stuff to smoke with everyone else on this party magazine, because I just don't see it. There is nothing in the memos that obligates them to do anything. No laws have been stricken from the books. What we're calling legalization in Oregon and Washington still hasn't moved any of the old laws that we still use against them. So, just as I warned before, when the government first came out with its pronouncements, and we subsequently were seeing twice as many raids as under Bush, I'm warning people again, these pronouncements don't mean anything, they have no legal standing, and they're not even being respected by the U.S. Attorney.
Right. So what do you think is going to happen, though, Steve? Like, is this like what they've been doing with the medical thing? They're going to say one thing and then do another? Or what do you envision happening?
Well, let's look at what has happened. The pronouncements, the phony promises, the threats made by the Attorney General, Eric Holder, were successful getting all of our people, our activist organizations, our leaders, our politicians in California to panic and try to draft a draconian, unconstitutional AB 604, which thankfully failed last night. Now, the other side, Alan St. Pierre, NORML, all of these well-intentioned, intelligent people will tell you that we have to do this in order for the Fed to get off of our back. Well, there's no reason to believe that anything going on here other than to panic people into doing the job for the Fed. You know, as an activist, I learned now that if police can do something to you, they'll just do it. If they can't legally do it, they ask, would you mind stepping out of the car? Yes, I would. Would you mind telling me if you have any drugs, or if I look inside your car? Yes, I would mind. Because we know that if they have to ask, they don't have the power. And this is just what the Justice Department is doing. They don't have the power to go up against state laws passed by lawful voter elections. They have no ability to go to court and check that. They're powerless. They also don't have the budget they used to have. So what have they done? The only thing they can do is to panic at this leader, politicians, to passing and enforcing the office order. And that's what AB 604 did. It created a new police force. A new police force to go after anyone who is making, selling, growing, involved in any sales, any commercial operation, and the West raid them, take them to jail, charge them with new felonies created by AB 604.
Yeah, well, it seems like there's a lot of this sort of accepting all of the concessions or throwing in a whole bunch of concessions just in order to get you know, the backing or, you know, like the DUI in 502 or some of these other things where they put things, they put stuff through thinking it's making a concession and helping us, but sometimes it's hurting us, not helping us. So I guess, Steve, in with this one, isn't it just time will tell? We'll see what happens. Like, though Obama, you know, has been going after some medical marijuana places, there's still 20 states with medical marijuana. There's medical marijuana all over the place. You know, there's dispensaries and states all over the place. They haven't really done a major, major crackdown. So it seems like...
Oh, yeah? Oh, yeah? Try going to the Ukiah, you know, County. It's swarming with federal, and the war continues. The U.S. attorneys basically gave Eric Holder the finger and said, hey, we're going to keep doing exactly what we're doing. The federal suit against Harbor, full speed ahead. Nothing's changed. Nothing has changed. The war continues. You know, it's a little embarrassing to see the leadership in this movement profiting off of this false hope, telling people to make a donation, send the money, the winning, you just need a little more money. It's also disturbing to see a lot of naive people in the cannabis business happy to register for the Fifth Amendment protection. I'll bet right now the guards are picked off because they know that everybody's going to get the green revolution and they're going to have a whole new crop of defense.
Steve, for some reason you're breaking up there. I'm having a really hard time hearing the last, like, couple sentences that you said. It's just giving us little bits and pieces of the whole thing. But yeah,
that's okay. I'll move.
Yeah, maybe I'm not sure if it's a reception issue or what, but yeah, you were saying a bunch of stuff. We heard the first part of it about you know, the leadership of the movement and stuff like that. But just in fairness, I mean, everybody has a different opinion of what's right and what's wrong, and you know, I guess there's different ways of interpreting things. I'm not sure if it's entirely. I wouldn't want to say. You know, I would criticize anybody for collecting donations or anything like that. I mean, that's how some of these organizations work, right? But, I mean, sometimes we don't always agree with everything that they do. But, I mean, the majority of, I think, what some of these groups do, like MPP and NORML and stuff, they do a good job, even if I don't agree with everything that they do on every level. Is that fair to say, you think, Steve?
Well, if they do such a good job, why are we still watching this drug war continue and being told that it's ending, that it's winding down?
That's not really fair to those guys. There's a lot of reasons we still have one. Because the bad guys are powerful and they don't want this drug to be legalized. They don't want our sacred plant to be legalized because it screws with everything they've been holding so sacred and dear with their control structure for so long. So that's not the fault of NORML or MPP or anything.
Trying to make a different point. I'm not saying that NORML is wrong, that these other organizations are wrong. Well, what I'm saying is that it's wrong to lull people into a false sense of security. When this war is going on, the DA is not going to pay attention to anything that Obama or Holder say. We're going to continue to ignore Holder and Obama, and someone needs to stand up and tell all of these people, wait a minute, don't be fooled. The war continues, and you need to be aware of that. You need to be careful, and we need to push harder and not accept these tidbits. The sucker that's being thrown out at us. We can't demand that our people be released from the cages that they're being held. Getting left is to be released. Roger Cripps, I'm ready to be held without bail. These are not acceptable. The war is not acceptable. The pronouncements being made by the Justice Department are BS and not acceptable. We want our people released. We don't want all these BS rules and regulations imposed upon us out of fear.
Right.
That we have to do it in order to please the federal government. No.
Yeah.
We have to stand up for what we believe in.
Steve, you're breaking up again. I'm not sure what's going on with the reception there. But we've got an article we're going to publish called Eric Holder's Drug War Deception by Steve Kubby. That's coming up on Cannabis Culture over the weekend. Marius had a question for you as well, Steve. It's really loud in here today. There's like loud traffic and all kinds of stuff going on. So there's already stuff going on, but we're also seeming to have reception problems. But Marius, so your question for Steve, what was that?
I'd just like to ask you, Steve, whether you think that the recent Senate committee hearings on states versus federal medical marijuana laws, and also John McCain's recent pronouncement that he thinks that maybe marijuana should be legalized, as any sort of progress at all, or like I seem to think that it seems to indicate that there's some progress, because before that they were completely stonewalling. So although I'm like I'm not happy with you know, the status quo, and I certainly don't believe Eric Holder is like true to his word or anything. Do you think that we have made any progress?
I think we've made tremendous progress with the public. The public is clearly with us and against the war on plants and people. But the only metric that I use to measure progress by is, have people been released from jail? Marijuana people, have they been released from jail? Have laws?
Well, certainly that's the final step, but I mean, to say that there's no, to use that as the only metric for progress, I think that's like, you know, I don't think that, I think that you ignore everything else, if you know what I mean.
Well, Mario, as long as, that wasn't my only metric, I gave you two metrics. The second metric, probably the most important, is that any initiative, any meaningful action on the part of the government have to include the removal of bad laws. As long as those laws are allowed to remain on the books, the police will continue to spy on us, arrest us, humiliate us, bankrupt us, and put us in a
I think I see what you're saying. I think that you believe that we're in a period like the late 60s, where it looks like we've made a lot of progress, but it could just evaporate overnight if we're not careful.
Exactly. Yes.
Well,
thank you, Steve.
Why any initiative that I support must include the repeal of laws that are on the books right now. That was the mistake that we made the 50s, is we didn't repeal the laws, and the cops ignored our system and used the laws against us anyway.
Thank you, Mr. Kelly.
Awesome. Well, Steve, thanks a lot, man, for everything. Now, I wanted to talk about something before we let you go. A project you've been working on for a little while here that we just launched yesterday, and it's going to actually be officially launched starting at the beginning of next week. Tell people a little bit about Cubby TV.
Well, Cubby TV is state-of-the-art broadcasting, audio, editing. It's an effort to bring some professional standards to how we communicate with each other. And because of my long involvement with this movement and all of the people that I know, I'm able to bring a large group of leadership to our show so that people can benefit from their thinking, their views, their wisdom. In addition, we're going to be covering the business of cannabis, the culture of cannabis, all things related to it. 5 days a week, in your face.
Uh-oh, did we lose him again? We got in your face, and then we lost you.
I'm right here.
Oh, you're there. Okay. Yeah, we seem to be having some reception problems.
I've got plenty of bars on my phone, so I don't know why we're having a problem.
Yeah, you just keep cutting out. Yeah, we're really solid, too, here. Although, actually, we're on 3G now, so maybe we're not as solid as we thought. We usually it's on LTE, but for some reason it's downgraded to 3G. Downtown internet signal not always so good here. Mm.
That's for sure.
Yeah, but no, it's usually pretty good. We're solid on 3G. But yeah, I'm not sure, Steve. We just lost the last little part of there. We heard...
In your face.
In your face.
Well, the show is going to be 5 days a week, starting this Monday. And hopefully, we will... You know, I get the Pot TV news 3 days a week. And it's my hope that we can use the new technology available to us to do a better job than Pot TV. To this day, there are people who tell me how Pot TV news got them through terrible times.
Yeah, now, because you're a Pot TV alumni, you were with Pot TV a long time ago, and we had a great show, and that's what you're trying to kind of bring back now. And this is going to be 5 days a week on Pot TV. You guys will be able to find it on our YouTube channel and on the front page of pod.tv as well, 5 days a week. So I'm hoping, Steve, you're still there. It does keep cutting out one way or another, but yeah, cool. Well, we'll definitely be watching out for all of that stuff. And the first episode you had there was just kind of talking about the holder stuff. And you had a quick interview with Vivian McPeak that was pretty cool. He had some inspirational words. So everybody should go and actually check that out. Cubby TV on Pot TV right now. Pot.tv. Check it out. Steve, thanks a lot for coming, man. Appreciate having you on the show. Always a good guest. Everybody loves you. So we'll definitely have you back again soon. And we'll be seeing a lot of you now on Pod TV 5 days a week.
Let's all call in and make sure that that new minister will allow Mark to come back to his home country.
That's right. Yeah, everybody definitely has been overwhelming the public safety minister of Canada's telephone with calls. We did a call-in campaign for getting Mark to come back to Canada because he's been allowed by the U.S. government to come back through the treaty transfer process, but the Canadian government has yet to actually make a decision. Unfortunately, they are lollygagging, not talking about it at all, but according to a few of the journalists who tried to call in, who were writing for the local papers like the Vancouver Sun and the Province, they wrote that they couldn't even get through when they tried to call, and that when they did finally get through, the government officials who answered the phone were like, is this about that Mark Emery thing? Or they basically had already, they knew what they were calling about. So we're making waves there, no doubt about it. You know what happened? Like, Steve, you were saying before, this just shuts the phone lines down when people call in and do this kind of stuff. So it causes problems for the powers that be when their phone lines don't work. You've told us on the show about some of your experiences.
Well, it's absolutely shameful that the U.S. has given permission and Canadian authorities have not acted in a timely manner to allow Mark to return to his home. I mean, it's bad enough that they allowed him to be handed over to the U.S. officials, but now that he's been released, it is absolutely shameful that they haven't acted to bring him back.
Yeah. It is shameful. Oh man, everything that this government does is shameful. That should be the new name of the damn party. It should be the Shameful Party of Canada, because essentially everything they do is hurtful to this country and the people in it. Unless you have, you know, millions of dollars in the bank, I don't really see how any of their policies could possibly help anybody. So
I think that in Canada, Harper is going to be synonymous with shame.
Yeah,
everyone's going to say the word Harper and they go, oh.
I sure hope so, man. They have scandal after scandal.
Well, I understand that he threw the last election.
Absolutely. And there's definitely evidence, like robocall scandals, all sorts of things like
that. There are so many scandals that are just waiting to explode with this. You know, that's why they keep proroguing Parliament and stalling it, because they're always afraid of the backlash from some of their scandals, like torturing people in Afghanistan or overseas, or giving money to senators to do all kinds of shady deals behind the scenes and all kinds of nasty stuff. But
we gotta get Trudeau into office.
Sorry, say that again, Steve.
We have to get Trudeau in office.
Yeah, no kidding. That would be fantastic. Definitely. If we could get Justin in there, oh man. Yeah, he definitely seems to be going to bat for our side, so let's just hope that that's not smoke and mirrors either, but he seems to be authentic about this one. Anyways, cool, man. Really appreciate having you on the show. And we'll definitely talk again soon. Peace,
okay.
Steve. We'll see you on Pot TV 5 days a week, my friend.
Take care.
Bye.
Steve Kubby. 5 days a week on Pot TV. Kubby TV. Yeah, it's going to be pretty dope. That should be good. And Steve always has lots of good stuff to say. Also, I'm going to mention the article again that will be up on Cannabis Culture over the next couple days here. Eric Holder's Drug War Deception by Steve Kubby. So that's his take on what's happening with Obama. A little different than Alan St. Pierre's. So it's been a good range of thought on the show today. And so we also... Oh, I keep dimming that out. We also have... my friend Brian to come over. Do you want to come talk about this whole thing or what? Yeah. Sensible BC.
Hi.
Brian's here. Brian from Sensible BC. And what was the topic we were going to talk about? Sensible BC is doing a lot of canvassing, ramping up for its 90-day period of collecting signatures. But I don't have all of my canvassing stuff yet. This building should be fully equipped. We need more places like this building where people can actually go to sign up, right?
Yeah, we need a lot of stores, storefronts or whatnot. If you know anybody who has a store, any friends, family, try to get in there, or local places. We need a lot of people to host, because right now it's just the organizers doing local times, local events. So we need a place, a permanent location where people can come in to sign up. That's what people have been asking for so far.
Yeah. Yeah, we need a lot of these stations, because it just is, at this point, people want to sign up, but there's not enough places to do it yet. And it's actually partially the part of Elections Canada and getting some materials and getting all those things and actually having them all in place, right? And actually getting the cards verified and all that stuff. Now, how does that really work? Can you walk us through the process? Like, are you fully done as a canvasser? You can go and do anything? You have your card and everything?
I don't have my card yet.
You don't have your card yet?
No.
Wow, so...
Actually, so I got my card.
Marius
today,
has his
just
card.
Today.
That's good.
So does that show up in the mail or something?
No. They go out to... we're getting them in PDF files, so we give it to the riding organizers, and they have to pull out all the people from their riding and contact the people and get the meet with them.
Right. So where does the card come from, though, Marius? Where did you get your card?
I went to the office in the Dominion building.
Ah, I see.
So, and they were able to print a card out for me there.
Well, what we need to do is I'm going to have Dana Larson come on, or we'll just, I'll go and talk to him personally, and we'll get a big, like, how to example of how this is all done and walk people through the process, because we really need a lot of this happening all over the damn province. So
and also, like,
it needs to be as clear as possible for everybody.
Each canvasser needs like forms for every writing.
Yeah,
as
and that's
well.
The,
and then like, so you make photocopies and keep the original.
That's what's so it's a lot bloody of work. Bizarre about the whole thing is that if you're you have to sign the right forms for your particular riding that you're in.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
If people come down to the Vapor Lounge here, they could be from any different riding in British Columbia. And we have to have the forms here for every single riding in British Columbia. And how many is that, 85 or something?
Yeah, it's 85.
85 ridings. So 85 different sets of forms we need to have. Now, and but this seems unlikely that every single canvasser is going to have 85 sets of forms. But I guess if you want it, can you just get 85 sets of forms?
You can. You can get all the ridings. But if, say, you're in Burnaby, you're only really going to need the Lower Mainland.
Right. I guess it depends on who you're trying to canvas to and where you're going and what you're doing.
Sometimes there's people from Victoria, but that's more of in the tourist areas. If it, if you're at a SkyTrain location, it's mostly people coming home from work. So.
Yeah.
Right now, with how it works is... there's the canvasser registration form, so people have to fill those out and send them in. Once we get them, Dana has to sign it, and we send it off to Elections BC, and then Elections BC processes it and then sends it back to us. And we have to confirm that we have the card and then get it to our organizers for the organizers to give to the canvassers.
Yeah.
And getting it waits, or we have to, we're waiting a week for canvasser cards back from Elections BC or longer.
I see. So there is a process.
Yes.
Wow, it's crazy that there's only 3 months to do it, but yet there's so it's not really the fastest process in the world. So every second counts with this stuff. So go to sensiblebc.ca. Go to sensiblebc.ca/canvas. Where else is there? Anything else people should know? And really, what's the main thing? Like right now, you guys are you're talking about you need more places. So if you know somebody with a business or you know somebody that has a location that's like a set known place in a different riding, we need their help as well.
Or just approaching people.
Approach them. Yeah, yep. Go into your local businesses and say, can we set up a station here? And in fact, it actually brings people business. I was walking home. I just moved downtown, and I was walking to my house after work, and I saw a guy standing outside waving a stop sign around that he had in his hand, and it had a Sensible BC thing on the back, so he was just stopping people on the street and bringing them in.
Yeah.
And into this local business. And so when people were going into the local business, they were going and getting drinks and sitting down and doing stuff. So
yeah, definitely people are looking for the locations.
Yeah.
So you'll get people who are not normally going to come into your business.
Yeah.
Definitely.
It's good for your business. Mm-hmm. So that's right. Mm-hmm. Set up with Sensible BC. It's good for your business and good for your karma and good for everybody. Good for the herb. You want a bong rep?
Sure.
I just wanted to reiterate something that Dana Larson said. And that also something I'd heard as I was getting my canvassers form is that we need canvassers within the city of Vancouver. You'd think that we don't have enough, but actually people are kind of blasé about it because of the police haven't really been enforcing. Mm-hmm. So, and also what I heard today is that we need canvassers in Surrey. There's not enough there. If you are in Surrey and you want to be a canvasser, contact us right away or contact your... Yeah, it was sensiblebc.canvasser. So go there, and wherever you are, try to become a canvasser.
Awesome. Thanks, Marius. Good reiteration.
No worries. Happy
and
canvassing.
Good new information. Happy canvassing. Yes. Yeah, please. You know, Sensible BC, it's actually, I really like canvassing. I like going out and doing that stuff. Maybe it's just because I like talking to people I don't know. But I think you can have a really good time with it. And it kind of allows you to, if you're not used to doing that kind of thing, it kind of teaches you some of those skills as well. So there's a lot to learn about social interaction when you go out and approach people that you've never met before and try and get them to do something for you. It's kind of an interesting thing, you know, or get them to do something for themselves or whatever.
And meeting
just get
the,
them to do something.
Yeah. Meeting the other canvassers as well. You're meeting people who have similar interests with you most of the time.
That's right. Yeah, it's great for that too. Meet new people. There you go. Well, we have another video to play, I think, before we end the show. I just don't have it in front of me. Let's find out. Constantly moving around here. What were the other videos? Oh, I see. So, oh yeah, there's a couple things here. Yeah, there's the Denver billboard. Now, we didn't really cover this on the show much, and it happened a few weeks ago. But in Denver, there's MPP working there, Marijuana Policy Project. These guys are great. And Mason Tavert, he's basically one of the guys who single-handedly, well, he didn't single-handedly, there was lots of people working, but he was one of the key activists behind the Colorado drive to legalize, and he did a really great job there. And so Mason is in this clip about a big billboard they have there encouraging the NFL to accept marijuana as an alternative to booze, because a lot of, you know, there's always these stories that come out about these sports stars who have all these crazy, terrible problems with alcohol addiction, or, you know, they get boozed up and violence, yeah, do crazy things and all that kind of stuff. So, you know, pot would definitely cut down on a lot of that stuff. It's definitely a safer alternative, and that's Mason's whole thing. So let's check this video out, Marius. This is MPP in Colorado. Big billboard, NFL.
Did you hear there's a Broncos game tomorrow night? And it's bringing the national spotlight to Denver, and pro-marijuana advocates are taking advantage using this billboard right near the stadium just put up to get their message out. The electronic sign is demanding that the NFL respect Colorado's recently passed Amendment 64.
But their message goes much further than just football. They hope all the attention here tomorrow helps them get their word out. Fox 31 Denver's Julie Hayden is live near the billboard with a story new at 9:30. Julie?
We're right here at 17th and Federal, and this is the billboard that we're talking about. And as you said, they put it right next to the stadium. And what they're hoping is that all the high-profile nature of the game, the league, and the players leads to a much broader discussion about whether any employer can punish a worker for smoking legal pot.
When the game is over and a Denver Bronco football player heads home to relax in Colorado, it's just as legal for the player to use marijuana as it is to grab a beer. And a pro-marijuana group says it's time for the NFL's pot policies to catch up with the new state laws.
We don't think the NFL should be punishing any players simply for using marijuana, because it has nothing to do with their performance, and the NFL is not responsible for policing marijuana.
The pro-marijuana group is posting a billboard overlooking Sports Authority Field Mile High, saying the NFL is, quote, driving athletes to drink.
If you want to go out and get drunk, you're not going to face any sort of penalties. But if you use marijuana and get caught, you might be suspended for a number of games. You might lose hundreds of thousands of dollars of your salary, and your livelihood is literally being threatened.
Fans are mixed.
If they want to be able to do it, then I understand there's league rules and all that, but shoot. All for it.
I don't think he should be punished. I think you should be able to smoke marijuana.
I disagree with that. I think they should be held to a higher standard.
It's an interesting tactic being used.
Legal expert Dan Rex says no doubt the billboard will get people talking.
And it will spur public debate, and that's what they want.
And predicts it's when, not if, the NFL changes its marijuana policy.
Things do change in the world, and things even change in the NFL.
This season, the NFL does say that this policy is part of its collective bargaining agreement with the players' union, and it has no plans to make any changes. In Denver, Julie Hayden, Fox 31 Denver.
Thanks, Julie, and supporter.
Shoot.
Sorry. They can hear you, but the camera.
Thanks, Julie. There you go. Marius' fingers slipping off the button there.
I hate trackpads.
Yeah.
Almost any day. And even so that, Windows 8 sucks.
I was going to play one more video before we go, I think, because we don't really talk a lot about jury nullification on the show. And I think that it's a valid thing that more people should know about, especially in the United States where...
NJ Weedman.
That's right. That's the one. Now, this is NJ Weedman. Ed Fortune. He is a really cool guy. He was at Seattle Hemp Fest this year, and I heard him speak about... speak about jury nullification, and that's how his case was dealt with. He convinced his jury to let him off, even though he admits he was guilty. So he has an interesting story, and I like his presentation and how he tells his story. There's a cool clip here from Reason TV that I wanted to play for you guys. It's not too long or anything. It's just Ed talking about... Oh yeah, it's less than 10 minutes. So, but this is Ed talking about jury nullification. And then once we get back, we'll wrap the show up. And then actually there, after the show tonight, we're gonna play the second episode of the Kush Brothers for you guys. This is episode 2 of the Kush Brothers. That's the weed guy, Mark Clokeed, and Remo, the urban grower. And that's their new project, Kush Brothers. We've been progressively publishing. Well, we have the first two episodes up, and one will come out every Thursday. So, and then they're working on the second season already. I was upstairs with them just a couple days ago filming one of the segments for the second season. And that is going to be a crazy video because we smoked so fucking much weed. Seriously, Remo rolled a joint that was the size of his arm. That was just this huge joint. I took some photos of it, actually. Maybe I should publish one or two of these. I published one of them on Instagram, I think. But I'll publish another one of the giant joint right in Remo's face. Literally him rolling up this big crazy thing. And we had bags and bags of weed all over the place. Those guys just take it to the next level. Yeah, it was a lot of fun. It's all in good fun, of course. It's responsible use. We're all pros who know how to handle our intake. So there was no greening out anywhere.
There's paramedics standing by at all times.
That's right. That's right. We have a lifeguard who sits on a big high chair over in the corner. And then if anybody's looking like they're in trouble, she just jumps in. Okay, well, let's watch this video, Marius. The NJ...
Got it.
Here I am right now, standing before you free to talk. I should be 10 months into a 10-year prison sentence. The only reason why I'm standing here is because I happen to know about jury nullification, and I used it.
Hi, I'm Zach Weissmuller with Reason TV. I'm here with Ed Fortune, also known as the New Jersey Weed Man or the NJ Weed Man. He's a former marijuana dispensary owner, a medical marijuana patient, and an outspoken advocate for jury nullification who's successfully fought back multiple marijuana charges. Ed, thank you very much for joining us.
No problem.
Jury nullification is what we call the outcome when essentially a defendant has violated a law, but the jury believes that the law itself is unjust or not properly applied in that situation. How does jury nullification play into your personal story and the cases that you fought?
I was charged in New Jersey with possession of marijuana and possession with intent to distribute, but I have always felt that the marijuana laws were wrong. Opinion poll after opinion poll shows that more than 50% of Americans believe that marijuana should be legal. Taking those numbers and putting it on a jury, I believe that anyone charged with violating a marijuana offense should be able to argue to his jury that the law is wrong and should be able to get about half the jury to say not guilty.
So you had medical marijuana that you'd obtained in California and brought to New Jersey. Then what happened? A police officer pulled you over?
A New Jersey state trooper pulled up next to me at a light. I don't know if it's because I got nervous or whatever, but he was paying attention to me. I had my front tires over the white line, and that was the pretext stop that he used to stop me. He said that I disregarded a traffic signal because my front tires were over a white line. Anyway, he pulled me over. He asked for a search, if he can search. I said no. It didn't matter. He put me in a car. He got a judge a couple hours later to sign a search warrant, and they searched the car, and they found my suitcase with my luggage, my toothpaste, and my medicine.
They seemingly had all the evidence they would need to convict you under the law. How did you win that case?
Well, basically, I was guilty. I got caught red-handed, too. But the fact of the matter still goes back to most Americans believe that marijuana laws are wrong. And that was what I argued. First of all, I represented myself. I think people who are charged with a marijuana offense should represent themselves. And I don't mean totally by themselves, but at least give their opening statement. So that you're identifying with the juror. The jurors can identify with you. And that's what I did. I gave in my opening statement, I basically introduced myself, I removed myself from being a criminal and turned myself into the victim of a wrong law. And I explained how I smoked the joint this morning, I'm going to smoke a joint at lunchtime.
And we should explain that you do have a very serious medical condition that you say the marijuana alleviates, right?
Yes, I have bone cancer. I got diagnosed 13 years ago. I've had a couple operations where I've had tumors removed. The last 3 years, I've been suffering with a huge tumor in my right femur, which is basically just painful. It's pain levels. And I could get on Percocets and hydrocortisones and all kinds of pain medicines, but I have chosen not to. I didn't want to be addicted to those dangerous substances. Instead, I use natural marijuana for my pain.
How much of your argument were you actually able to make that, you know what, this law is wrong, I'm the victim in this case? I imagine that would be a challenge to even be allowed to say that in a courtroom. So how much of that were you able to get in?
All of it.
Really?
Yes. It was my mission. It was a whole plan of mine. I've been calling myself a New Jersey weed man for the last 15 years as I was advocating the legalization of marijuana. But I always had this plan, and the plan was jury nullification. I could have just easily called myself jury nullification man. So to me, when I went on trial, it was like my Super Bowl. Like, it was like I've been planning for this for a long time. And basically, the judge and the prosecutor and all the pretrial lead-ups tried to stop me from saying certain things.
Right.
I went around them, even just representing myself. You know, I'm giving my opening statement. Mm. The prosecutor gets to say what he thinks the case is about.
That might be an advantage of representing yourself? Because defense attorneys are probably afraid of being disbarred. Yes. and mm-hmm. other kind of punishments, right?
I think it's a must. You know, I've been telling a lot of people over the internet how I did it, how to do it, and I think that's like number one. You should represent yourself. And even if you don't totally represent yourself, you should at least give your own opening statement. Because like I said, you're removing yourself as the criminal in the matter, and you're turning yourself into the victim. The number two thing is jury selection. Some people would argue that jury selection is number one. Mm. But juries aren't like superhuman, super Americans, super patriots. What they are, they're everyday average Americans. They have brothers, sisters, cousins that smoke marijuana. On my jury, I suspect at least two of them smoked marijuana. I was looking for potheads on my jury. I looked the stereotypical pothead, you know. I'm not, to be honest with you. I'm very highly motivated. I get things done as long as the government doesn't bother me.
There's a lot of pressure, like you mentioned, from the prosecutors, from the judge who's going to be saying things like, you need to follow the law as the law is explained to you. I've sat in mm-hmm. drug courtrooms where they say it's not about the morality of the law. It's not about if you like this person or not. Those are huge hurdles to overcome. When a figure of authority is saying that to a jury, what do you think was the most important thing in kind of breaking past all that?
I think by representing myself and speaking for myself, I put myself into a different category. There's a lot of anti-lawyer animosity in America too. Hmm. So I capitalized on that. You know, I described my prosecutor in that good terms, and I felt like the prosecutor and the judge and even the public defender were all on the same team, where I describe myself as, being on We the People's team, and you, the jurors, that's the team I'm on, and I actually begged them to save my life. I predicted that there was at least 50% of my jurors are going to believe that marijuana should be legal. I said that I would probably get 5 or 6 on my side. As it turned out, I got 7. Prosecutor, he decided to retry me again. And the second trial, the only surprise that I had was that I got 12 this time.
A kind of broader critique that you hear of jury nullification is that, you know, laws come about through a process, and this is kind of subverting that process. It's undermining the rule of law to just have these rogue juries deciding what's right and wrong. In some situations, it could target minorities because an all-white jury might nullify a crime against a minority plaintiff. So how do you respond to that kind of critique of nullification?
Jury nullification absolutely is a double-edged sword. I mean, it cuts both ways. Mm-hmm. Generally, I look at jury nullification as a barometer of public acceptance. There are laws that we can look at and say that are wrong or were wrong, and the public starts accepting that prior to the legislators. The slavery acts of the 1850s, right. You know, the public wasn't down with slavery anymore, so they weren't going to help people getting prosecuted for helping slaves escape. During the alcohol prohibition here in America, same thing happened. And that's why I think we're at that stage in history now with marijuana. Even if the person doesn't smoke marijuana, they're on the internet, they're reading the truth, they don't believe the lies that the government said. You know, the government is has turned into the emperor with no clothes.
If anyone runs into trouble and finds themselves in a position where they need to defend themselves and they want to pursue the strategies you've been talking about, what's your advice? Where can they look for resources? What's the what are the first steps?
The Fully Informed Jury Association, FIJA.org, is an organization that puts out a lot of information. I got a lot of information from them. I have information on my website, njweedman.com. Represent yourself, speak to the jury yourself, actively and aggressively challenge the law. Say the law is wrong. Here I am right now, standing before you free to talk. I should be 10 months into a 10-year prison sentence. The only reason why I'm standing here is because I happen to know about jury nullification, and I used it.
I'm glad for that, and thank you very much, Ed Fortune, the New Jersey Weed Man. Thanks for talking with us. No for Reason TV, I'm Zach Weissmuller.
NJ Weed Man, he's a very cool guy. We definitely had some fun at Seattle Hemp Fest. It was a smoky endeavor there. And I really like his honest way of speaking about everything that's happened to him and stuff. He just is a very cool guy, and I definitely like what he has to say, and this jury nullification thing needs to be used more than it is. It's one of the tools in the toolbox. All right, well, so I guess this is the end. This is the end. End of the show, Marius.
All right.
Thanks to everybody who showed up today. Alan St. Pierre, Steve Kubby, Brian, the girls, Megan and Mel, and who else was out here? Anybody? Marius? Yeah, it was good. Obama, I guess we'll just have to see what happens. That's really all we can do. And I think there's a lot of good and there's some bad, and there's a mix of both. I'm not really sure where I stand on this whole one. I stand somewhere between Alan and Cubby on this whole thing. I think it's possible that this could lead to something kind of negative with Obama and their continued war if we allow that to happen, or if the pressure is on and they're forced to actually continue down this road. You know, because this just doesn't happen in a vacuum. Obama's not just doing this because he wants to or something. They're being forced to do this in a lot of ways, where the public are actually pressing them to make these changes, at least make them in rhetoric only. So,
yeah, precisely.
Maybe they're going to, just continue the rhetoric to try and pull the wool over everybody's eyes. But the public want answers, and that's why Obama has to do this, because the public sentiment is just overwhelmingly in our favor. So they can't continue to do this. They're going to get voted the fuck out of there. They really will. Eventually, there's going to be enough legislators, probably. I hope.
Well,
jeez. I don't know. I don't think it's quite like the 60s where it can just go back. Public opinion is really overwhelming right now. People are tired of this shit. So, but who knows?
Well, I wouldn't become complacent in any event. But yeah, it seems this is the second time around. So that's definitely a difference between that now and the 70s and 60s.
Right. But we'll see what happens. That's all we can do. And yeah, thanks, Marius, for your help today. Awesome. And we are going to play. Oh, actually, we forgot to take that commercial break. But that's not what I wanted to play. But you can play the commercial and then play the Kush Brothers if that's possible.
Okay.
You want to do that? We're going to quickly play a commercial. And then the commercial is for our store downstairs. It's a commercial that I made for our store that I just was digging through our things and I found. So I thought I'd play that because I was going to tell you guys about the massive sale that we're having at Cannabis Culture headquarters right now. That's right, in this building, our bong store downstairs. The reason I'm able to sit before you today is because my paycheck is subsidized by the store downstairs. And, of course, what we do here at Cannabis Culture and Pod TV, we do sell advertising. Mm-hmm. But a lot of the resources for everything that happens in terms of activism in the city of Vancouver and us comes from our sources of income, and that's including this lounge and the downstairs store. And, yeah, there's a big sale, up to 80% off glass in the store, up to 80% off heady glass in Cannabis Culture, ongoing sale, back to school. It's the glass is in session sale. I see they stole the name from Al.
No, they didn't steal the name. They copied it slightly. Yeah,
it was appropriated. That's right. Well, that's right. So Yeah, I definitely would advise coming on down here and checking that shit out, yo. Slashing the prices, it is. It's a big clearance. 80% though on a lot of items. That's a crazy sale.
Yeah, we are insane down here.
Where's Crazy Dave? Get Crazy Dave out here. Everything must go. And yeah, there are loud sirens in this room. I see people like I see Hash Mob giving us a hard time in the chat about the gain on the mics. You know, you don't understand.
The sound
of that siren is louder than my voice in my ear when it happens right here. It really is. It's so loud because we're on a main road and all of the emergency vehicles come right down right in front of our open windows and they're piercingly loud, literally louder than my voice. So I'm not sure if that's a Marius issue over there on the board or if that's
it might be. I had the gain up high because this we have a new soundboard and it's not giving up as much power as the other one, probably because we have four microphone channels as opposed to two. So I did experiment with having the gain up a bit, and maybe it was a little too high. I won't push it
Marius is tweaking knobs over there.
But thanks for the input.
Awesome. All right. Well, again, Peace Pod TV. Thanks a lot for watching. Love you guys. Check out the CCHQ commercial, and then check out the episode 2 of the Kush Brothers. Peace. I'm gonna smoke the bong. Legalize it. Don't criticize it.
For the food.